Whenever feasible, one should always try to eat the root. Would you join me at the table?
Welcome to Eat the Rudecast, a podcast about NBC's Hannibal and the works of Thomas Harris. I'm Cooper, and I have tonight...
Hi, it's Miko.
Hi, this is Ophelia.
Very silly. Very silly.
It's like, I have tonight.
I have. With me.
With me.
With me, I have. Tonight we're drinking before the podcast, obviously. And we're drinking both Strongbow hard cider... Mm-hmm. And Angry Orchard hard cider.
Yes. It's an autumn evening.
It is. So the hard cider works with it. Mm-hmm. It's not in theme.
No.
But there really was no definite theme to the drink tonight. We're still in the Japanese theme of the meal.
Yes.
And while last week was the name of the overarching meal style.
Yes.
This week we have the name of our first course, mm-hmm. which is...
Sakizuke.
And that's, see, you pronounce it differently. Now, see, you gave me like a far more American sounding one. And then when you come to pronounce it, it's just like completely different. So I would be the butcher. That's why I just had you say.
Oh, okay. It's just Japanese with American accent.
Well, there we go. Okay.
That's all.
So that's episode 2 of our second season. Tonight's episode is directed by Tim Hunter, who has directed many episodes for this show. Also, I was just reading the book about the making of Twin Peaks, and he is all over that.
Mm-hmm.
All over it.
Right.
Written by Jeff Flaming and Brian Fuller.
Mm.
So we opened pretty violently.
Yes. I cringed during the entire first part
tearing,
of the show.
Lots of yes. tearing.
Gut-wrenching realism, too. Mm-hmm. That is how it would feel to have stitches ripped. That is what your skin would do. That it's very, very real, and it puts you in that place where you're, oh, I can feel that pain, mm-hmm. and it just gets you right in the stomach and makes your stomach turn.
Yeah. You just, oh, yeah. What I thought was interesting is that it looked extremely graphic. And then when I watched it again, I realized there's almost no color in it.
Right.
Right, yeah.
But the first time I watched it, it was almost like, it seemed like scary technicolor, like, ah, they're ripping, and there's, oh, there's skin in there. They really did a psychological number
on it. That's the thing we talked about at the beginning of the first season, that NBC has told Brian Fuller, you want blood, make it darker. Make it darker. Make the blood almost brown. Make it almost black. And you can do it.
Yes. And they don't lose anything by doing that.
In fact, the darkness works for it, mm-hmm. I think. And, you know, this is one of those examples where, looking back, I remember it being extremely graphic.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if my version of it from the past is built up anyway. But this is obviously a producer's cut, so we are getting a more graphic scene
probably
than in the original.
More detail, maybe longer.
Probably a little bit more, probably a little bit more close-ups.
Mm-hmm.
When I noticed a scene-by-scene comparison, shot-by-shot comparison from the first season, from the Angel Maker episode, they did a comparison with the producer's cut and the regular cut, and it's just they linger on shots longer, they cut away to fewer onlookers, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the same stuff, just slightly more.
Right. Right. They let you soak it in little bit longer.
Marinate in that red goodness.
Yes, yes.
So I have a question
mm-hmm.
that comes right after he frees himself.
Okay.
Because he's walking over the bodies. Was it completely by chance, or did the killer know that he got free?
Well, the fact that the killer was there, I wrote, why do you suppose the killer came back?
I mean, I've got, how did the killer know?
Yeah.
Did he have cameras overlooking the eyes?
Even if he did have cameras, you got to wonder, okay, how far does this killer live? We don't learn a lot about the killer.
No.
How far does the killer live from this location?
Right.
Is this his farm?
Right.
Does he live on the farm? Mm-hmm. In that case, you could assume that he heard screaming out from the silo.
Yeah. There is screaming for quite some time.
Quite a bit.
So that if he lives in a farmhouse near these silos,
then he might hear.
He might have heard.
Which is a reasonable assumption, though. Then the question is, I guess if you have that kind of land, you don't really worry too much about people wandering onto it and looking in your silos.
Mm. True. That's not going to happen.
I don't know. It was an interesting thought, and it obviously made us all pause. I was more impressed by how poorly locked the silo was.
Yeah.
That this man who just tore himself out of the mural mm-hmm. was able to jam his way out of a padlocked door.
Yeah, quite easily.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's true. It's not like, unless it's that. That kind of strength that comes from adrenaline and
I'm sure he was full of.
Yeah, that thing that makes moms pick up trucks off of kids.
Exactly.
You know, that it could have just been the overwhelming madness of I need to save myself and everything kind of running through his system. You can kind of say that, but, it did seem rather effortless that he... there was a moment where I didn't think it was even padlocked. Because it was so easy until you...
Yeah, he just hit it twice and it was out.
Yeah, it seemed really
easy. Which I think is a little bit of cheat on the part of the filmmakers here. We need to get him out of the silo so he can run, so we can get that tense thing.
Yeah, we can't take the time to be real. Right. Because we can't have the audience sit there and watch him beat himself up against the door for the length of time it would really take. So we're suspending disbelief here so that... We can move along quickly.
Did you notice the same screaming sound in the background and the soundtrack as in the season one finale when he's waking up, when the music is discordant? There was that same sound from Will's dream.
No, I didn't even... I noticed there was an accordion sound.
Really? You noticed an accordion?
Yes.
I didn't notice that.
In the background, during the whole time while he's pulling himself out... And it's getting more frantic.
Yeah.
It's a discordant accordion. They're not playing anything.
They're just going back.
Opening and closing it and opening. And it starts out small and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And then they start doing it faster. And I noticed it because it was really unsettling.
Yeah.
Because it was out of tune. And it was just like the bellows being pulled and compressed and pulled and compressed and making that, that weird accordion sound. And I think it's because I think I didn't notice it the first time, but I noticed it the second time because I wasn't looking at it. I was taking notes and the sounds.
And so you just heard it, yeah.
Yeah. But I didn't notice the scream. I don't know how I didn't notice
it. It was just subtle, and it was only in the very beginning before he busts out of the silo.
Mm. I remember just listening to the soundtrack for this particular scene in the chase that it was just... Very suspenseful, very psychological thriller, and it kept me on the edge of my seat for even the second time watching.
Tense action scene. The run through the corn, the killer in the shadows, always backlit.
Oh,
that was really well done. Through the cars, the lit up dirty car windows, and
trying to hide in it, and that whole some of it was like. Stuff you've seen before.
Yeah.
You open the car door and the other
and
one's
gone.
Open.
Yeah.
Right.
But I was okay with it,
Well, the one shot that really stood out to me at both times is when the killer gets into the corn and has the flashlight on, and then the flashlight goes off and the camera does this weird sort of swoop move.
Yeah.
That goes through two rows of corn
to our victim in the foreground.
Our victim, and what is our victim's name?
I love the name of our victim because his last name is Umber.
Roland.
Oh,
Roland Umber?
Roland Umber.
Roland Umber.
Umber is a color.
It is. It was the burnt umber sedan that they got in Fargo.
Oh, that's right. Burnt Umber.
Isn't it Burnt Umber?
Yeah. I just watched that, too. I don't know why I care about
that. You get that true coat.
You betcha.
So let's talk about the cliff jump at the end.
Oh.
Because it is such a surprise.
God, it is. Because you're filled with so much hope.
You're like, yes. Yeah.
And he's gonna get to the FBI.
He does this leap, and he looks like he's far enough away from the edge.
And he just sort of, his leap turns into a dive that collapses.
Oh, and again, surprisingly graphic.
Yeah, when he hits the rock, there's the sound, which is very realistic.
Mm-hmm.
And then...
upsetting.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Yeah, this whole intro was extremely violent, but not violent in the way of, okay, we're watching this bad thing happen to this bad person or this, you know, innocent person. But it was more, I can feel that.
Yes.
It was like, it got under your skin and it made you...
It was very visceral.
Yeah.
It was very, You were experiencing it with him.
You could imagine what it would feel like to have to pull yourself out of that mural.
Oh, and we can imagine the stitches pulling out, and the huge chunks of flesh. And then having to run,
and all of the above.
Yeah, and the whole time he was going to the cornfields because you get slapped with those leaves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's all I kept thinking of while he was going. That God damn, that's got to hurt.
Yeah,
he has exposed
open skin.
You like, talk about the adrenaline. Mm-hmm. That's really where it's coming through.
Totally.
Go.
Yeah, just because you know whatever's behind you is not.
He's getting hit by branches and trees and just running.
It's
and running.
Much worse than anything you could possibly do to yourself.
Right.
And then you get that moment where you see him on the edge of the cliff, and you're like, yes, he's going to do it.
He's sort of like a defiant, and you're not going to get me. What I found interesting, though, is that he didn't run and jump. He just leapt off.
He leapt off the edge.
And I had that moment of, you idiot, you run and you jump off a cliff. You don't just jump right off.
Oh, yeah.
He didn't have time to think.
That's true. And
he didn't have time to calculate his trajectory.
Physically.
Maybe
do
he was
much
spent.
Running and jumping.
And tell you what, you're on the edge of the cliff. That guy's getting ready to shoot you. You don't run towards
him
to get a little bit
of
space.
True.
Although,
and
if you started running towards him,
it may have
freaked the killer out.
Honestly, though, having just woke up from where I was and realizing that, I think number one, I wouldn't have run back towards the person who put me there.
Yeah. Right.
Number two, I wouldn't be 100% convinced that I would have a slow, but a quick death his way.
Mm-hmm.
So I would have taken that jump.
That jump.
Because that's preferable to having to be sewn alive into the mural again.
Yeah. The choice is not that he's just going to shoot you.
Because he doesn't know the killer's motive. He has no idea why he was chosen. He has no idea why he ended up there.
Mm-hmm.
He has no background information. He knows that he's being chased by
he
this
just
person.
Just woke up in a big pile of
for all he knows,
sewn to
the guy
sewn
wants to put him back in that mural. And honestly, if I was going to take my chances off of, you know, taking a very short leap off of a rocky cliff, or going back with where that guy is, I probably would have just done that. Cross your fingers and hope.
Oh, yeah. And they didn't have to show it to us, because he does go to the edge of the cliff and shine the light down, and we get to see the dead body.
Right.
In
the water.
Well, you know Brian Fuller, he likes to hit us with these things.
Yeah.
This is the stuff that you know he's sitting there behind the monitor.
Exactly.
He loves it, and he loves it so much because it is, again, an example of things you don't see on television.
Mm-hmm.
Not just the gruesomeness, but the lack of survival.
When people jump off a cliff
to get away from the killer, generally they hit the water.
Mm-hmm.
Fugitive.
Yeah. Yes. Well,
exactly.
Like, that's what I'm thinking.
Exactly.
Tommy Lee Jones wouldn't care.
Right. Exactly. And then it's that whole thing of, oh, the person who is pursuing them just believes that they're dead, and they have that moment
where
they don't
been
see
dead.
A body.
Yeah,
and
the,
then
the water, yeah.
Somewhere down the river,
they swim to shore,
exactly.
their head bobs up.
And it's all happy, and the puppy's licking the face.
I think, oh, there's puppies? Oh, puppies!
Happy ending.
The Wendigo's downstream, drinking from the stream.
Man.
So, this is cool, because this is the first killer And we can't call him the killer of the week because he's really the killer of 2 weeks.
True.
But this is the first killer that we have engaged with enough that makes us want to talk about him.
That's true.
And it's interesting even more so because we know nothing about this killer.
No.
By the end of the episode, all we know is he made the mural. Mm-hmm. He doesn't believe there's a god.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And the mural's not finished.
Right.
That's what we learn. Which is really fascinating that the show doesn't feel the need to give us more.
Right, all that explanation. And I'm fine with it because what I've always found fascinating with the killers on the show is the act of what they do.
Mm-hmm.
And while psychologically I love that stuff too, because I can really get into why somebody, that's why I love this show. Why would they do that?
Right.
Where? But I was fine with that in this one. It was just such a fascinating idea. And it was huge, but did not seem out of the realm of possibility like the totem did.
Right.
Right.
Because he could have taken plenty of time. And clearly, with the way the bodies were being found, he was taking plenty of time.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
And plenty of time in a private space, so people wouldn't just wander by down the beach you know, while they're going to take pictures of the turns.
Exactly. Turns. If he hadn't dumped those other bodies.
If he'd paid more attention to this body, he wouldn't be found.
That's true. That's where they wouldn't have known.
Because they said it was hundreds of miles. The Beaver Dam was hundreds of miles from this farm where they ultimately found him.
Right.
They never would have stumbled across him.
Yeah, they never would have. Yeah.
It took a mistake like this to catch him. What? We jump to the lab here.
Mm-hmm.
And Roland Umber is on the slab.
On the slab.
And I loved how Hannibal was in the way.
Yes.
Oh, he was just so awkward and clumsy.
He had no idea how to behave, and he was clearly fascinated.
Oh,
and that was what was causing him. We see the mask slipping a few times in this episode, and that was one of those moments where he forgot how to behave amongst the people he's pretending with.
He couldn't, the sort of inner desires couldn't be suppressed.
Yeah.
That fascinating, when he leans forward and does the long sniff.
Oh, yes, and that beautiful sequence where the corn sprouts out of the body.
Oh, yes, and you watch it grow and it becomes the cornfield. They do that lovely
with the blue
sweeping
sky
jib move, and he's in the field like the body in the
And this episode
lab
does a lot of that,
where
it transports people from where they're thinking about something to the place they're thinking about. It does it a lot with Will. Mm-hmm. Will, it's more of a necessity because he's obviously very not movable at this point in the series.
Yeah.
But with that moment with Hannibal, it shows us how strong the scent is with him and shows us how much. It's sort of like, you know, you smell corn, you smell, oh, corn.
Mm-hmm.
Hannibal smells corn, he's in the cornfield.
In the cornfield.
And I think that's really something. But going back a little bit to that first lab scene, the Cadillou.
Yes.
The cracks in the oil paintings that contain the clues. Beautiful.
Yes.
Beautiful and so abstract and so not something you've heard before.
It's true, yeah.
And especially when talking about the body.
Right.
It is true, but how many bodies do we come across that have been shellacked?
Very few. Well, me personally,
and it's one of those things.
Not a lot.
Not personally.
Interesting to have his interests and his passions actually translate into something that is useful.
Yeah.
You know, that he has this wealth of knowledge. And I think it's...
like a chair of antlers.
Like a chair of antlers, yes.
That kind of useful.
Exactly. I mean, in the books, they go into this more than they do in here. Just the vast knowledge that he has. Mm-hmm. It's what makes him so difficult to catch and what makes him so unusual and quite possibly is why he is the person that he is. That he is this great intellect.
Yeah.
And you get to see some
He's
of that.
He's a sponge of fascination, too.
Yes.
So how about Bev totally fumbling the color palette suggestion here? Maybe it's a color palette.
Oh, God.
Right.
And you know, Jack just sort of glares at her.
Oh,
and Hannibal, Hannibal gives her that.
It's as though.
Yes,
it says
Will is in the room.
Will is in the room.
But just like, I mean, Bev twice in this episode sort of fumbles there. And when she says to Will, you know, I may not be able to do some of those other things that I need to do. And Hannibal's almost like, what are you looking into me? What were you?
Yeah, like, you know those other things.
It's like maybe,
that I'm
maybe
supposed to be
Bev
doing?
Should be cooler. Maybe she should calm it on down a
but
little
I
bit.
But I think it's wonderful that she isn't that cool, and she has to not be cool with it in order for them to have that conversation. You know, it has to be pretty obvious to Jack that she didn't come up with this herself. Mm-hmm. You know, so that you could lead into the. You know, did you go and see Will? Shut your mouth.
Shut your mouth. Bev in the principal's office.
Exactly. But ask her a question that tells her to shut up.
You know, that's
yeah, don't even answer my question, just shut up.
That moment was wonderful. Mm-hmm. That scene was not. Mm-hmm. See, that moment gave us awesome angry Jack, just like, use the ladies' room, and class dismissed, that Jack that right. we so much like. The rest of that scene is just exposition theater.
Oh, it is.
Oh, I'm getting a psych eval. Oh, go do your... It's like, we understand everything that's happening. The audience is not only on the same page, mm-hmm. we're on the next page.
Yes.
Could you let us know when you get here?
Yeah, stop assuming that we don't know what's going on, that we don't know who Katie is and what's going on yeah. with all of that stuff. Especially since we have a scene later on.
And we have previously on mm-hmm. Hannibal at the beginning of the episode.
Right, yeah. It was just, I guess, they needed to give him a moment to
They need to give him an excuse to say, shut your mouth. Maybe. Really. That's what it is.
And also to do the, I don't condone this, but we never had this conversation. So I didn't tell you to not do it, even though I don't agree with what you're doing. It was like a way of, okay, I think I know what you're doing now, and now I'm going to pretend we didn't have this conversation.
Also a throwback to Miriam Less.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed.
And the same situation that she was in.
Yeah, that really did feel very similar to that Miriam last scene.
It was almost
scene.
Verbatim.
It was like, go do your thing. I'm not going to know about it, so you're in trouble if you get in trouble. But go do it.
You know what your job is, right?
Right, exactly. And it's interesting to come off of the beginning of that conversation where he is talking about how he feels like he failed.
Right.
You know, and that, but then he's going to send her in to do whatever she sees fit to do.
He did have that nice moment, too, that where he points out not only that, so if Will was pushed too far, it's because Jack pushed him.
Mm-hmm.
If he was crazy, it's because Jack failed.
Yeah.
So on both ends, it's Jack actually taking legitimate credit mm-hmm. for what has happened to Will.
Oh, most definitely.
Which is a nice moment for Jack,
yeah,
because
this
he is someone.
This episode is about him owning.
Absolutely.
That. Yeah, because it comes up several times during this episode, because we see it later when he talks to the psychiatrist and the psychologist that comes in to do his evaluation. So it does come up. And then we have Will, who's struggling with himself, or the not knowing of himself, and how, you know, it's like, here is Jack, who thinks he knows exactly what he did now, and that he is secure in his failure,
yeah,
even though they're trying to tell him that maybe this may not have been a failure. You know, Will, on the other hand, is
now the unreliable narrator of his own story, which
exactly.
is so meta.
He lost the plot,
yeah. And this is something we've talked about over and over. How the narrators are growing less and less reliable on this show.
Mm-hmm.
Not just Will, but everyone is growing less reliable because for all the various stresses and for the fact that Hannibal is something. We had it pointed out on Tumblr that they don't think Hannibal is a psychopath.
Uh-huh.
And I think that's the best reason to enjoy Mads Mikkelsen's idea of Hannibal as the fallen angel, as Lucifer.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's not, you know, even though they keep talking about the intelligent psychopath, which in writing sort of fits.
According to my notes, it's pretty much right after, you know, we have our you know, torrid opening scene of
the
violence.
Escape.
we then it's the moment of Will having this conversation. Yeah. About, you know, how I've lost the plot.
With Hannibal and Alana in that crazy ornate cage structure. Yes. Why can't they go visit him in his cell?
I it's one of the things I've been meaning to research and I keep forgetting.
Or is this Will's time thing. In the yard? Here, now you can see a sun. So, you can see you can see a window.
Because some people are allowed, because Dr. Du Maurier goes to his cell.
When and people later do on. Visit him at his cell.
Yeah.
But maybe it's and when Beverly there's more than one. I don't know.
Yeah, but then they have these scenes.
Yeah.
Well, maybe it is. Maybe if it's more than one person, maybe they can only allow.
When Katie Purnell comes,
she's
in there.
But she's with two other people.
No, she's by herself.
Oh, was that the guards that come in?
Yeah, that was the guards.
That split off. Okay. I thought she came with her own detail. Because it when she walks in, rather than them walking out, they split off.
Oh, maybe. Okay.
So I just interpreted that she came with her own security.
Well, regardless, it's an incredibly evocative set.
Yeah.
And it's a very interesting...
And there's not just one in there.
No, there's not.
But the other ones are always empty.
Yeah.
But why do we have more than one?
When they get to associate... Maybe it's for group.
Oh, for group. Maybe. Maybe to have a... But
can't you imagine Dr. Chilton in there with a whole number of crazy people in each of them?
Maybe.
And say, and what do you think?
Yeah. Will does tell Hannibal later on, because he has, oh, they told me I can't go past the line.
Yes, because they've been peeing on the
their
therapist. That was so nice. It's like, I'm not interested in a pissing match with you, Dr. Lecter.
Exactly. Please move closer.
Okay, so, first viewing, Miko. Mm-hmm. Did you feel Will was faking right away?
Or no, did you feel it was later on.
Yeah.
It was later on. This one seemed genuine. And although it was interesting, I'm trying to remember, does he say it here? No, it is here. Betrayal, I need to trust you, you can trust me. So, 'cause he gets emotional.
Yes. And Hannibal says, and you can trust me.
And, you know, how he's like, I'm afraid to see, you know, it's like, I don't know who I am anymore. And he has that whole thing where, I'm, you know, the fact that what's worse, me thinking that I did it.
Or me thinking that you did it.
Or me thinking that you did it to me.
Mm-hmm. And Alana has that wonderful, observation. Poor Alana. Really, she just doesn't get it.
No.
And I don't think she's stupid. She just doesn't get it. But she says, Hannibal isn't responsible for what happened to you, Will. And neither are you.
Neither are you.
It's like, so you're right. Neither of them are responsible, ultimately. Really, neither of them are responsible. Neither of them.
So who ultimately is responsible?
It's like, clearly your judgment is compromised here.
Or she's trying so hard to ease his pain that she's just saying anything.
Well, no, remember, that's Alana's whole thing. That's why Katie Purnell is so pissed off.
Yeah.
It's because Alana's saying that the FBI made him this, and he doesn't remember, and he's not responsible.
That's true. That is true. But there is a lot of that. It did seem like he was baiting Hannibal. Like like he does.
He has that Academy Award winning breakdown.
And then he has the break. Exactly. And then they take him back to his cell. And they walk away,
and he's
and
intense,
it wipes
blind.
It away.
Yeah. And then credits.
It just melts, and it was like, that was an act! So I'm saying, I believed it, like, during the entire time he was doing it. And what was interesting, though, is that the first time it happened, I was confused. The first time I saw it, I should say. Because now that we're viewing it twice.
Has been very helpful.
It's been very helpful. Some things that I missed the first time are solidified, maybe because of what I have seen at the end. Once I go back and I see the beginning ones, I instantly understood what he was doing at the second time.
Oh, yeah.
That when he, and I'm like...
Well, it's a very different type of performance from Hugh Dancy.
Yes.
So we've seen him play really conflicted, confused.
Mm-hmm.
And this felt, I think it felt this way from the beginning. It felt very calculated.
Mm-hmm.
And so at the beginning, I was just like, okay, something's off with the acting. Is he I don't know, you forget how to do will over
little,
the summer.
A little melodramatic, yeah. But then you realize it's like, no, he still believes that he knows that Hannibal is doing something to him. And he is going to make him believe that he's breaking down and that he truly needs his help. But really what he's doing is he's holding a hand out so that he can pull Hannibal down.
Well, and he later in the next time they meet, Hannibal talks about friendship, and Will says that friends have a symmetrical relationship, which is sort of like, we're not friends, Hannibal. But then right away throws, we're just having conversations, though. This isn't therapy.
Yeah.
We're just talking.
We're just talking.
So he's even dangling the friend carrot in front of Hannibal now. So, I mean, like, he knows all these little things and that he can play.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, this is Will's clarity.
Yes.
Like, in the last episode, he talks about how, in the last episode of season one, he talks about how his eyes are open now.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is where we start really seeing that.
And he's really sort of using the play of words to manipulate Hannibal, into revealing what he wants him to reveal.
Absolutely.
If I continue to, you know, parry and step back and go, you know, and do this little, verbal dance with him, he's going to trip up, and he's going to tell me what I want him to tell me.
Well, I think it's interesting when Hannibal throws out the, now, even if you remember stuff, your memories are distorted.
Yes.
It's not the truth.
It's not the truth.
So he's sort of preemptively saying, you might remember stuff about me.
Me.
But that's just a distortion. No. That's not real.
No, your brain's making that up. Yeah. So it's made me really look forward to where this is going to go.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because now we realize this is a duel between the two of them. But I know it's going to be drawn out because this is way too much fun having Hannibal doing the Will stuff and Will doing the book Hannibal.
Yeah.
In the Silence of the Lambs Hannibal.
The manipulating from within.
Yeah. The, you know, the people being, don't get too close to him, handing things over.
Yeah, and it's interesting how tense it is whenever someone hands something through the bars, simply because you know you don't do that with Hannibal Lecter when he's in that cell.
Exactly. Exactly. Even though Will has never done anything to any of those people.
Right. Only to those guards in the ambulance.
In self-preservation.
Yeah.
Yet everyone is now terrified that he's going to leap out and bite their face off.
Right. When Hannibal talks to him about how he probably shouldn't be helping the FBI, and Will says that's the only thing that feels normal, Hannibal asks, the violence? Will says, no, the structure in the violence. And I thought that was really like a veiled jab towards Hannibal, as now I see the structure in your violence. Mm-hmm. I see the rungs. I see the blueprint now, which has got to be making Hannibal nervous.
Nervous, yeah.
So when Beverly visits Will, I love how Will talks about how Chilton is gossipy. He records everything. He's gossipy that way. Right. It's bitch Chilton. It's not on camera.
Oh yeah. Right. Well, I love how he takes every opportunity to take a stab at him because he just he just thinks he's just so just like beneath everyone and just any opportunity he has to point that out to people, like, why is this man here? He doesn't even have a degree, you know. It's like, kind of person, you know. It's like, how did he become the person that he is? It's like,
sure.
I
think if you look at Chilton, it's got to be a political thing. He knows how to play the political game far better than he knows how to play the actual psychiatry game.
But he thinks of himself as being, he wants to be that person who is published and is esteemed, and but it's never going to happen.
No. Well, unless he can crack Will.
Right, which...
Then he'd get a great publishing.
Oh, yes.
So did you notice Will withholding answers from Beverly is awfully Silence of the Lambs, Hannibal Lecter.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost quid pro quo. You need to do this thing. You need to agree.
Oh, that entire scene is very...
Strike the evidence. And I like the way he played that, too.
I'll do this for you if you do this thing for me.
Well, and it's not even, I'll do this for you. It's just, I wonder how many more people need to die.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's absolutely the most holding this over you way he could play that.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even, I'm doing a favor for you, Beverly.
Will you do something for me? I won't.
How many people are you going to let die because you don't want to help me?
Right.
And that's very
it's
Hannibal.
It's very Hannibal. Like I said, everything, especially in this episode, felt the most like Silence of the Lambs Hannibal.
Yes. Will asking for privacy and getting none there.
Well, that was a wonderful exchange. Just the wording of it. It was like, well, do you mind if I have... And just, yes, I do.
Yeah.
You know, which is really interesting because it's not an answer that most people will give.
Well, yeah.
Usually when you say, do you mind, most people will say, no, I don't mind.
And when you're in jail, you don't get the social niceties.
Exactly. And it's wonderful how straightforward, just, yes, I do mind. And it's a fun sort of, I love that even though Will is, never gets to go to any location now. And I actually got to a point, I think about 3/4 of the way through, where I was thinking, I'm sure Hugh Dancy is going to have like a movie come out after he did this season. Because he can do all of his scenes in half the time because he never has to go to a location. They can shoot all of his, incarceration scenes. He's always in the same outfit.
He is.
But what I love is that when he goes back and he's still able to do what he's done in other episodes where suddenly he is the killer in with the body.
Yeah.
And and
when there was no pendulum.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's just looking at the pictures, he almost it's almost like he's looking at like the picture on an iPad, mm-hmm. and then he moves it, and then it's there,
Right.
So the imprisonment thing, it's an obstacle for the filmmakers, but it's not an obstacle that can't be overcome.
Right.
And I really like that he's in the lab then, looking at the body.
Mm-hmm.
And he immediately knows that he wasn't killed by the overdose, because he's had... problems with heroin before,
mm-hmm.
and
he was resistant to it.
That's a nice thing because it's a very realistic oops
right.
for a killer that has things fairly well under control.
Mm-hmm.
Because you don't expect that. Because when Roland got picked up, he was nicely dressed.
Mm-hmm.
He was so you don't feel like I may have to adjust the dosage because...
Right. He just looked like the average guy.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't look, I guess, far enough back into his...
I wonder if the killer's actually looking into things other than, I see this guy, he looks like he fits my profile, let's follow him home and do something.
Right, he's not digging any deeper than that.
And Will has another Silence of the Lambs moment where he's talking about where the killer is doing these things.
Mm-hmm.
Someplace private, a warehouse, mm-hmm. a farm, which is very much... And I felt this killer had a lot of echoes of James Gunn, too.
Mm-hmm.
So it's again that I'm going to play with these characters whether you give them to me literally or not.
There was a lot of dialogue in this that made me think of the books. Like they were, again, lifting... liberally, not from that particular character,
mm-hmm.
or not from that particular action, but they would find snippets of dialogue that just worked perfectly for the moment. And that whole thing of he's going to be isolated. There was another one later on. I don't think I notated it, but it did feel like it came out of it came out of the books.
Oh, and a lot of this is, and this episode really. I think after we watched it the first time, I mentioned just how much tighter it felt than season one.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's really what makes season two so excellent, is like they've trimmed away all the miscellaneous fat.
Mm-hmm.
And they've kept the valuable fat, the good marble fat.
Right. Not the gristly stuff.
Not the gristle.
Yeah.
So we see corn.
We see corn.
We see something awesome. Hannibal bright daylight in the kill suit.
In the kill suit, yeah. Walking, just like hanging out. Everything is good. Was this, it was so interesting. I had a thought, though, when he was out there in the sunlight while, with his full suit underneath the kill suit.
Right.
Like, damn, that must be hot. It must be sweating in there. I know when yeah, I wear...
it's like a greenhouse effect.
Exactly. I know when I wear latex. there's a layer of... you know, of that accumulates. Yes. When and
three-piece suit. He might even have a cardigan on under it. You never know.
Exactly. But he climbs up that silo pretty darn spry.
He does.
When I saw him walking through, all I could think of was, do you like Huey Lewis in the News?
Yeah, exactly.
Because he looks so much like the same plastic rain suit.
Yeah, from American Psycho. When I think we've seen the director take things from movies and ephemera that he cares about, like direct lifts that are not stealing. It's, hey, look, you remember this thing from that movie?
Mm-hmm.
And I think I wouldn't be surprised if the kill suit was a, hey, look, you saw American Psycho.
Yeah, can we do something
cool like
that?
Although this one is tailored.
It's tailored.
It's not only tailored, but it has feet.
Yes.
It's like
footy pajamas.
It's a collar.
Hannibal would be doing very well during the Ebola outbreak.
Yeah. Well, his head's not covered.
Oh, let's not even go there. My goodness.
So
It is delightfully tailored.
It is.
It's even taken in a little... this is something that I noticed. When he turned and walked away.
This is why we have you.
Exactly.
To tell us about the costumes, because it's awesome.
It's awesome. But what I thought was really awesome, not just, I mean, because I've stared at it a number of times, because I'm amazed.
She is. She is mesmerized whenever Hannibal comes on screen, let's be honest.
That's okay.
Mads Mikkelsen mesmerizes.
Well, there's that.
There is that. But then the whole thing, how it's got this Mandarin collar.
Yeah.
And it is perfectly form-fitting. The shoulder is perfectly eased in there. There's no poofing or all of that is perfect. He's got that zipper up the front that I can't even imagine like putting that in. And he turns and he walks away, and it's actually tailored into his lower back.
I did
so
see
there's
that.
There is like a gathering of stitches across his lower back.
A little scrunch.
Because if you cut it just straight, it's going to bag out there, because we human beings are not, I mean, as slim as Mass is with a jacket and pants and the way a human bottom and back is shaped.
A human bottom.
A particularly nice human.
Danish bottom.
So yes, I was looking at his ass while he walked away.
Danish, right?
He's
Danish.
But I thought that was really interesting that they sort of tailored
it. Do you think his tailor, who does all his suits, had any concern over doing tailoring on this weird plastic suit? Did he say, this is for when I want to go out in the rain?
I who knows?
And this tailor said, in the shoes?
Right. Or maybe he told him he has a hobby where he paints or...
where he paints by explosion. On Mythbusters?
Yeah. I have a feeling that he could manipulate just about anyone into believing
anything.
True.
Okay.
Either that or in some part of his house... He's got a little sewing machine.
Maybe he made it himself.
And he's got one of those four.
Well, I mean, he has to be a sewer to make a person suit, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, well, he doesn't make the... Oh. I see what you did there.
Yeah.
Well, okay, let's go to Hannibal looking through the hole, which is like the eye of God in many religious buildings.
Mm-hmm.
And we get that wonderful swell of choral music when Hannibal's looking through and you've never seen glee on his face the way you see it when he sees this tableau out in front of him and isn't worried about keeping his person suit on long enough in case Jack Crawford sees him.
Right.
So he gets to look at this and experience it as Hannibal Lecter.
And then the killer walks in.
With his little airless. I have to re-varnish these people. We lost one. I need to re-varnish them all.
Right. Time to do the varnishing.
And just the way Hannibal delivers this line, or Mads Mikkelsen delivers this line.
Hannibal delivered the line. It's okay. Either way.
I love your work. But it's...
And no,
it's
no. Like, first, hello.
Hello.
Oh, hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Love
I know, and the
work.
Guy looks up like, just aghast.
Well, he obviously stunned. Didn't think that anybody would stumble upon his tableau. Right.
And make themselves known
to
him. Right. Not just, you know...
Oh, it's...
Or not just be the person who is coming to arrest him for his tableau.
Right.
Somebody who's come to appreciate it. That, yeah, he was definitely... And he's super skeptical of Hannibal.
Oh, yeah.
Well, of course.
But it is a great moment. And it's also a great moment because...
Does it take
we get to see a callback to this later on.
We do.
Which creeped the hell out of me.
Well, let's go there.
Let's go.
So we go to commercial. Nice. This show is really good at timing its cuts and commercials.
Oh, most definitely.
And when we come back, we have Jack saying, you might want to prepare yourself. You've never seen anything like this. And Hannibal just, I'm sure I haven't.
I'm sure I haven't. Exactly.
Half an hour ago.
Hannibal is far more flamboyant than Mads Mikkelsen's Hannibal.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, you did
love your work.
But it is like, that is what it sounded like in my brain. I don't know.
Exactly. But that is like a great moment of how he's trying to pretend that, you know, he's never been there. Prepare yourself, because I'm sure you haven't seen anything like this. And and the bodies are all over the place, and they go in and they're taking all their samples, and you get, you know, and then you see that there's the body, the extra body there.
The one in the middle.
That is not colored like the others. That inspires a wonderful children's song later on.
Oh, yeah.
Which I
you guys keep jumping to Will.
I didn't say what it was because I knew you'd be mad at me.
I only hinted at it. I almost sang it. I stopped.
I said, I know we'll get to it. But that they, you know, that they notice. And Hannibal has to kind of lay a smoke screen.
Right. Like, it's something reflected in the eye.
Exactly. And he kind of, you know, maybe it's an existential, look, and it's not really looking at anything. They have this really long discussion about what this eye is looking at.
Oh, yeah, and what they talk about, the last person,
the image on the retina.
That a person sees burned on the retina.
What's really interesting is Hannibal's laying it out for Jack there. Mm-hmm. He's saying that it's the reflection of man looking at God. So it would obviously be the creator of this tableau seeing himself. So, of course, it's the guy in the middle.
It's the guy in there.
But the more interesting thing in this whole scene is Hannibal's opinion about what makes people bad. Jack has the hoary line, what could make a human being so bad?
Right.
You know, it's like, okay, let's dial it back here.
Yeah.
But Hannibal says,
when
it comes to nature versus nurture, I choose neither. We are built from a DNA blueprint and born into a world of scenario and circumstance we don't control. Hannibal is telling us who he is.
Well, also what I thought was very telling, too, is that he uses this them to do what he is driven to do.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Because Jack is trying to understand how can someone be so divorced from their humanity that they can do something without feeling any remorse or any kind of guilt or even hesitate the way someone else would hesitate to kill or maim someone. He's trying to grasp that.
Mm-hmm.
And Hannibal's basically trying to explain to him that they are a means to an end to this person. They're not thought of as human beings, or they, but it is also an end that they are driven to.
And then we immediately flip over into Jack visiting TV's most boring psychiatrist.
Yes.
Where he's saying Will Graham was a means to an end. And then, I used it. I mean, this psychiatrist obviously is trying to let Jack off the hook. He is an FBI psychiatrist hired by the FBI to tell Katie Purnell what she needs to hear.
Mm-hmm.
But Jack saying, I look at my friend and I see a killer. I'm failing to reconcile these things. It was interesting that they kept cutting to Will. Mm-hmm. During this scene.
Mm-hmm.
Just sitting in his cell. Yeah. Like we were going to go to a scene with him, but we never did. Yeah.
It's almost as though this is the image that Jack is playing in his head.
Right.
Is the image of his friend as sort of like a cold-blooded killer sitting in the cell. You know, and that whole thing, the world feels much darker, you know, and he's struggling with the responsibility and failure. And this is the image he can't get out of his head is... You know, my friend is a killer. And what I found interesting when he used the line, the world feels much darker, one of the notes that I had written earlier, and I had written this in the previous episode, is that the color palette in this season is muddied and dark. Mm-hmm. We no longer have intense, vibrant colors. We do still see some of the blues echoed in Jack's shirts and ties. And we do see some of the colors in Hannibal's suits. But they are not the sort of sapphire blues and vibrant reds that we were seeing last season.
Right.
And no one's assigned really much color anymore. And everyone is kind of lit very dark. That first scene with Alana and Hannibal and Will, Alana's face is half in shadow, and they shot part of it through the bars.
Yeah.
So that the bars were sort of obscuring.
They've really enjoyed using the bar imagery.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So it was fascinating for me that Jack is seeing the world as being darker.
We go back to the lab,
mm-hmm.
and we have the kind of scene we haven't seen since season one, Sorbet. Which was the dinner party episode,
mm-hmm.
where they're talking about something, and then we cut to Hannibal.
And then we cut to Hannibal.
They're talking about the missing leg,
mm-hmm.
and then we cut to Hannibal cutting up the leg on the bandsaw.
Very graphically.
With our good friend Ludwig van.
Yes.
And the Ninth Symphony.
Mm-hmm.
And boy, what superb.
It is.
Music, and you know, I was listening to this after the episode, and I find it hard to listen to that without immediately hearing the next track from Clockwork Orange.
Mm-hmm.
It's so wonderfully played here, and the leg on the bandsaw, my God!
Yeah. Not just that, but we see him trussing up the leg for the meal.
Yeah.
Oh yes, and he prepares this gorgeous meal.
Yeah.
And he's preparing it for himself.
Yeah.
So it and creating our logo image
exactly
in one fell swoop.
In one fell swoop, exactly.
But I mean, this is the fascinating life of a crazy person by themselves.
And he would take all that time.
Yeah.
To make this extravagant meal for no one.
He's
himself.
A busy
right?
guy.
Yeah.
Well, and when does he eat those leftovers?
Well, you know,
does he have an entire freezer full of leftovers?
He's got a
baggies?
Big house, yeah.
He does.
Well, we did.
He has those freezer bags that, you know, minimizes.
Well, we saw how he freezes his preparation stuff.
Okay.
But that's we true. Don't know what he does with the other three, because he's a man of refinement. He's mm-hmm. not going to sit there and eat two for dinner.
That's true.
Yeah, have one for lunch the next
day. He's going to send it in a doggy bag. To Dr. Chilton.
Exactly.
But Chilton can't eat meat anymore. We forget.
Right, that. Right. That's true. That is true.
But crazy elaborate meal.
Yeah. And what was wonderful about it is that you have, you know, all of them around this table trying to come up with this, you know, well, why did he cut the leg off?
Oh, it was a souvenir.
Like,
oh,
it was a souvenir. And then you do that cut to Hannibal.
Or.
You know, and they go back and they're still talking. They cut and they kept going back and forth. You know, because it wasn't an entire scene.
And it was just that little musical sting.
Sting in the moment. And then once the music progressed, you started seeing him really doing the preparation and taking it out of the oven and sitting down to the wonderful meal. And I love what, you know, he pulls, the recipe he pulls out was for ossobuco. You know, that he takes these, you know, real recipes and applies the appropriate body part.
So now the scene you both have been wanting to talk about, Will putting himself in the mural.
Yes.
Okay. Hannibal and Beverly come to visit Will, because now Hannibal's in on it, too. Mm. So Jack's just, you know, whatever. It's just like, okay, if everyone wants to go visit Will, fine.
Fine.
Get me a killer.
Yeah.
We hear "This Is My Design" again.
Yes.
Which is awesome.
Mm-hmm.
He talks about it being a dead eye.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's this it's almost philosophical about vision and consciousness. Mm. And then we go to "one of these things is not like the other."
One of these things is not the same.
Just doesn't belong.
Doesn't belong.
I'm sorry. Oh my goodness. It's been a long time.
You two were so excited.
Since Sesame Street.
And you sang with him. You sang it with him.
Yes.
I know. I'm sorry.
I think on the show they used to do it both ways.
I think they did. Yeah. I think they went back and forth.
Yeah.
Because
I remember just "isn't the same," I think, was later. Yeah. But it
just
was
a different verse, but that's not the one that...
Right.
Yeah, that's not the one that Will uses.
Will uses. That's correct. Yeah.
What a great moment when Will looks down and says, "Who are you?"
Yes.
"Why are you here? You are not my design.
Who lets
Why
you
are
in
you
here?
So different?"
And then he looks up.
Well, what's great, though, is the sound.
Yeah, you hear hooves on the roof.
It's like the sheet metal bending, and it is actually a very creepy, echoey sound.
Oh, yeah.
And that brings his attention up. And we get that Wendigo.
And his face is this weird, sad sort of Hannibal.
Yeah.
But sad.
Mm-hmm. What seems so significant is it looked exactly like Hannibal did when he was in the silo.
Exactly like it.
And the fact that it was so well lit and seemed more human in color and texture than he had before.
Yeah.
Where he had that kind of greasy, black,
sort of
shiny, otherworldliness. It was like we were getting a peek at who the Wendigo is.
Well, and Will then immediately puts it together when he has Hannibal sewing him into the mural.
Yeah.
It's wonderful that he's using dialogue that Hannibal told him previously.
Mm-hmm.
So Hannibal's not only doing this, but giving his reasons for doing this through previous dialogue, which is "killing must feel good to God,
yes,
too."
Oh,
because
yes.
We're talking about God. Yeah. We're talking about seeing the Creator. And then when Will says whoever saved him took a piece as a trophy, and Hannibal's eyes like, "Well, he must have had a friend."
Yes, exactly. Which is that great callback to the friendship conversation they had had earlier.
Because Hannibal's just so desperate to figure out this friendship thing.
Yes.
And
maybe he had a friend.
But then that's the moment that Will is certain, I think, that Hannibal was involved, is that "he must have had a friend" is a tip-off.
Right.
Because it's so odd of a thing to suggest there.
Right. You know, whether or not this was someone that he knew, but it was, he definitely sort of figured out that this is someone that he may have stumbled upon or had some connection with. It's like, you have something to do with this, so I don't know exactly what it is, but you definitely have something to do with it.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, and that whirring sound came back.
Yes,
yeah,
as soon as we see the window go.
Yeah.
Such a wonderful musical sting, whatever that is he's doing there. I want to think he's spinning something around.
Like the old noisemaker.
Yeah.
Actually, what I imagine is, if you've seen how they used to do, the whole old Foley artists used to do, like, thunder and wind.
Yes, yeah, like
it
the
was
wind
that,
machine.
It's a big, like, almost looks like a treadmill or a conveyor belt, and it has a big handle. And they used to spin the handle, and that conveyor belt would
having seen Brian Reitzel's recording studio for Hannibal, it would not surprise me to think that he has old Foley equipment and he's using it in the creation of the score for that.
It'd be interesting to find out if we can find what that is, because it seems too deep to be small,
yeah,
unless it's being
Well, I mean, he could certainly, he could certainly be manipulating it all.
Exactly. But that's what I see in my head, is that gigantic, you know, conveyor belt. It's like a barrel almost, and they would turn the handle.
Yeah.
And it would make that wind noise. And that's what it sounds like, is that done in a lower register. But it is so low that I can feel it in my chest. And
it's upsetting.
It's really an upsetting sting.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So we talked about how one of the few things we learn about this killer is that he doesn't believe there is a God,
mm-hmm.
Which sort of negates everything that everyone's telling us this is.
Right.
It's like when you project something onto a piece of art,
mm-hmm.
that the artist has no intention of.
Right. Exactly.
And so then that's why you almost never want to talk to the artist about what they truly meant. And David Lynch is this way.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Is that what you want to hear from the artist?
Yeah.
You want to hear that there's value and meaning because it means something to you. The last thing you want to hear is, yeah, it's whatever you want it to mean.
I actually read an interesting article where they talked about that. They were like, you know, is there such a thing as experts? It was sort of what the article was about.
Mm.
And that's what it was. It's like, you can sit there and look at an art piece or look at what someone did in a film and say, oh, I think it was the example was something like... something blue, like a person in a painting has blue eyes or something like that. And the expert or the person reviewing it, it's like, oh, well, it's blue to show the sadness,
mm-hmm.
and blah, blah, blah. And then when they actually talked to the artist, it was like, I just felt like putting blue eyes. It seemed like a, you know,
I like blue eyes.
I liked it. You know, or that was the
color.
Yeah, it's the color I had at the time. You know, that we do see.
I was out of brown.
To project. And I remember having arguments like this in grad school.
Sure.
Because when people who were supposed to be grading me would tell me that what I had done was wrong, I would be like, well, how do you know it's wrong? Because it's not the way you would design it.
Right.
So you are the be-all and end-all of how this is interpreted. If I gave the director what they wanted, the director is happy. I have thusly designed it correctly. Whether or not you would have designed it correctly.
Along those lines, when the killer says there is no God, mm-hmm. Hannibal says, well, certainly not with that attitude.
With attitude.
I mean, so dismissive.
Right.
And so dismissive of the artist's, using the term loosely, obviously, mm-hmm. the artist's intention.
Mm-hmm.
So Hannibal is finishing this piece of art.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, it's going to have Hannibal's intention.
Right.
So let's talk about Katie Prunell.
Prunell.
I've noticed that she has dropped the second R from her name, too.
Oh, she has.
Okay. Well, in the way she pronounced it, it very much sounded like Katie Prunell.
Yeah.
So she visits Will to threaten him.
Mm-hmm.
And Will is so smug here. Sounds like I'm unemployed.
Yeah, exactly. Do I still have a job with the FBI?
What's to be done about that? Which is... definitely Hannibal's line.
Yes.
From episode one, isn't it? Episode
it's
two.
Like, it's, yeah.
When our good friend.
Yeah, Freddie Lounge.
Freddie Lounge.
Yeah.
Was
What's
there.
To be done about that? I thought that was
very rude.
A wonderful line, because as I've been, you know, enjoying this interesting transformation in Will of, like I said, taking on the Hannibal in Silence of the Lambs. That was definitely another one of those beautiful moments of, oh, what's to be done about that?
And the idea that he conspired with his neurologist to fake an illness. It's like, okay, to then have the illness? So he conspired with his neurologist to get him sick? Can you give someone encephalitis?
Yeah. That's going
it
pretty
seems
far.
Like, yeah, it seems so far-reaching, and I mean, I get it.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter what the truth is. What matters is what the jury will hear and will believe.
Right.
And Will very spectacularly melted down.
Mm-hmm.
So it's believable, but it's still this bizarre, we have nothing, so here's what we're going to do.
Right, right. Yeah, we're just going to tell them anything because that's what they're going to hear, regardless of whether or not they're going to hear that you're a murderer, regardless of whether or not you can come up with anything that, you know, refutes that.
Right.
They're going to hear us telling them that, and we're going to give them everything that we could possibly come up with. And what was interesting about that is, like, she's coming right out and saying that we're just going to manipulate the jury.
Right. Because why not? Because what's Will going to do? Say, by the way, Internal Affairs was here.
Right.
They're just going to manipulate the jury.
Exactly.
And Jack's going to be like, are you kidding me? So She talks about it wanting, she's trying to help Will save his life by cutting this deal and having him plead guilty.
Yeah.
Will says, I guess I'll have to save my own life.
Mm-hmm.
And then turns away from her right into his memory palace.
Yes.
Because he turns away, and mm-hmm. as he's turning, we hear the river.
Yes.
And he's there, and then the bodies are floating by. Now, do you suppose, both of you, that mm-hmm. that these bodies are the bodies that we've already seen in the river? Or these bodies are representative of how Will is going to save his life? How he recognizes what Hannibal is now? Because he says, I'll have to save my own life, goes to his safe place,
mm-hmm.
and his safe place is invaded by bodies.
I don't think we were seeing it, when I was looking at it, it didn't seem like it was a premonition of any sort. It seemed to me more like this was Will's struggle.
Mm.
That here he is trying to go to his safe place, but just as Katie Purnell has come in and basically told him, doesn't matter who you really are. This okay. is how we're... It's almost as if his demons were
it's
invading.
It's horrible outside, it's horrible inside.
Right, that he's going to have to do a lot of work.
Yeah.
Because now even his memory palace is being invaded because he's... That's kind of what I was getting out of it. Not that he was finding any clue in there, but it was sort of this indication that of the trouble.
Sure.
That he's going through. And it is going to be a great...
big struggle.
A big struggle and a big journey to get to that place. That's kind of what I saw in that there.
So if you are a viewer
mm-hmm.
and you've been sitting here listening to us talk for an hour and been like, guys, there was another character in this episode.
We have not forgotten.
We have not forgotten about Bedelia Du Maurier.
Yes.
Because Gillian Anderson continues mm-hmm. to impress the ever-living hell out of us as Bedelia yeah. Du Maurier. So let's talk, let's go all the way back to first scene, post-titles.
She left her house.
She left her house.
So officially,
she's a
Bedelia
she's real.
Actually, she's out of her house in three different places in this
yes.
episode.
Mm-hmm.
So either she's not an agoraphobic, or...
she's so terrified.
Or that.
She gets over it.
So...
really, that's what I
is visiting Hannibal's house. And mm-hmm. I want to step outside the show for a moment. Hannibal's house, Hannibal's office.
Mm-hmm.
Are they the same place?
I don't think we figured that one out.
No, we haven't figured that out yet.
Okay. Because I think they are.
Because
we only see one exterior.
That's true.
We've never seen...
Yeah.
If Hannibal's house and office are not the same building,
mm-hmm.
we have never seen the exterior of Hannibal's house. And we've been to Hannibal's house enough times...
Right.
...that I think we would
have. We would have seen
so
it.
So I believe that Hannibal has this fancy, nice house...
Which
and then an
thoroughly
annex
makes
side
sense.
Building.
It
yeah.
does thoroughly make sense.
Because when you have your own practice, why go elsewhere,
Right.
And I think Hannibal would want to stay around, where the bodies are buried.
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay.
Well, it gives him less also to control.
Well, we'll revisit this again yeah. later in the season.
Because
we do see more of Hannibal's house and Hannibal's office this season.
Okay.
And it's just something that Sound on Sight has been talking about a bunch.
Mm.
And I've just been... trying to figure out if they're the same place.
Okay.
So Bedelia comes in.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed an acting quirk that Mads Mikkelsen has. And it's something he does a lot. He does sort of this sideways
noticed.
Stand.
Yes, I yeah. noticed it too.
And yeah. his head looking over his shoulder,
mm-hmm.
tilting up.
It's almost...
That's how he reacts.
It when he the whole time they had this conversation, and he was standing that way, what I found interesting about it is it was almost like a fencer's stance.
Yes.
He's
made his body small.
Yes. He has, he's sideways. He only has his head facing her through the entire conversation until she goes in and says something
yes.
that is threatening.
Yeah.
And the scariest thing in that scene is him turning his body to face her.
Yeah, because he's got it.
Because I'm going in... for the attack. I am not, pretending to be anything. I'm not shielding myself. I'm not, you know, I'm not going to deflect anything that you are going to send my way. The minute she says, I have come to the conclusion that you are dangerous.
Yeah.
He goes full body and advances.
What I loved is when Hannibal steps around his desk and notices Bedelia take a step back.
Yeah.
I think that's the moment Hannibal realizes she's not his friend.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's the moment where he sort of sizes her up.
Yeah.
And, you know, he checks in. Mm-hmm. Did you talk to Jack? Did you tell Jack about your concern?
Right.
When she says no, then he takes that very aggressive walk towards her.
Mm-hmm.
And we see the close-up of his feet on the floor.
Yeah.
And it's just like... And
she's doing the step back.
It's he knows completely that he's in control. She is playing the I'm in control of my life and my relationship with you card. But Hannibal knows he is one.
Mm-hmm.
The moment she takes another step back, you know, the first time it's like, okay, we're both sort of like, who's gonna fire the first shot in this duel? But when he walks towards her and she just keeps going back, he doesn't even need to do anything.
I think he starts walking forward when she does the, he asks about Jack.
Yeah.
And then she says, well, why would I? Because I would make myself look just as guilty.
Yeah.
And I believe that was what you, something like that was what she had, you know, had intended.
That was your move.
Your move.
And then she talks about, she drew a conclusion based on the glimpse that she saw through the stitching of the person's suit.
Yep.
Wow. And that conclusion is that you are
dangerous.
Hannibal tries to keep her.
Mm-hmm.
Did you notice that? He throws out a lure to her as she's leaving the room.
Mm-hmm.
By saying, I'm resuming Will's therapy, by the way.
Exactly.
So it's this, even though I think he's lost his respect for her because she's afraid.
Right.
And that would be, you know, but then maybe I'll see if you'll still stick around.
Right. I'm going to throw you this
because of Will. Stick around because of Will.
Yeah. And you two deserve each other.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I do love how even though she's backing up, and she holds her ground, and she does the don't come to my home again.
Right, right.
That even though it's obvious she knows what he's capable of, and the possibility of what could happen by confronting him here, that she could just say, "Don't ever come to my home again."
Well, she's drawing her line now. It's his move to step over it.
Mm-hmm.
Then she goes and visits Jack and is recusing herself.
Recusing herself. She uses wonderful words.
Well, she does, yeah.
Oh, this
She doesn't have any other patients. She sits at home all day and reads the dictionary.
Reads the dictionaries. All these SAT words.
When I thought it was really interesting how this was played with Jack, because he's respectful, because he doesn't have a lot of interaction with her.
Mm-hmm.
I like the can't see. It would be irresponsible if she continued to see Hannibal.
Yes,
and she's not feeling secure right now.
It's interesting because she's saying it without saying it. I can only help him if I feel secure.
Right,
and it's like I know I don't. And it's one of those things where it's those hesitations. It's like what Will was doing earlier. It was like, you know, I believing that you were doing this to me. You know, she kind of does that here in the I don't feel secure in myself. There are these interesting pauses.
Well, Gillian Anderson is very deliberate in the way she talks.
Extremely deliberate.
Clearly thinks everything through as she says it, you know, and it's a really icy and strange and unsettling performance, but a really good one and a rich one at the same time.
She speaks so much in this episode. There was a point when she was, I think at the end when she's speaking with Will, where I was wondering what the choice was for her to have this very interesting cadence to her speech, because it's not natural. It has a very interesting way of pausing and going up and then going...
Well, it could be walking.
It is. You know, I did think that. There was one point I was like, she's got like a walk-in way of speaking. It's funny that you would say that, because I did, I was trying
this
to...
Watch.
This watch. Yeah, it's like, it's commas in all the wrong places.
Yeah. I heard that Christopher Walken asks that all the commas be removed from his scripts, and he puts pauses in where he wants. Where? I have no idea if that's an apocryphal story, but I've heard that.
I think he told like a story somewhere that that was a joke on that about the laws of punctuation and that he didn't believe. I can't remember it. I thought it was like on a talk show, but I don't know whether it was a joke. But that was when I was trying to think of... another example of that kind of speaking, walk-in did sort of come up in thinking about it. But it's far more, has more peaks and valleys than walk-in does. But it does have that halting, commas in all the wrong place kind of way of speaking. And then also the way the words come out of her mouth, she fully says, like you could see her mouth wrapping itself around the words and almost oversaying them. Mm-hmm. I just am curious to know where that, why that choice was made and what that comes from. Is that just something that came up when she was doing the character? Is it something that was told to her in development? Sure. I really would love to find out, because it is so different.
It might be a commentary on the first episode with her in it. We should take a look at that.
Oh, definitely.
Did you like how Jack tries to recommend Hannibal as a psychiatrist to her?
Yeah. It's like, I hear he's pretty good.
Jack, I don't think she's going to go see her patient as a psychiatrist when she feels that they're traumatized together.
Yes.
And stop recommending. We know you didn't like your little psych eval guy. I'm surprised you didn't suggest you go to Hannibal.
Right.
But that was such a... You know, I hear he's very good.
I hear he's very good.
It's like,
exactly.
Shut up, Jack. Shut up. Recommend Alana, if anyone.
I know that it's hilarious. And then even here, she does that whole thing of where I know that... She sort of subtly indicates that she knows... that if things go down, the FBI are going to come to have her. But I love the sort of polite, the I prefer that you don't.
Right.
You know, that she is basically, and it's kind of like what she does with Hannibal. She's very upfront.
And it's a nice thing because she can't just run away from this.
Right. Well, she's, by the end of the episode, she's gone. Yeah.
Like a ghost. Okay, so Bedelia gets a visitor's badge because apparently the Baltimore Hospital will let anybody go see Will.
Well, she is.
She is a psychiatrist, but she's not his psychiatrist.
No, nor but FBI. you don't know who she, you know, who if she has.
She might have a relationship with Chilton.
She might.
Yeah.
She might. She might. Okay.
You don't know who she knows.
No, that's true.
You know, where she, you know, she's Hannibal's psychiatrist, you know, she's got a...
Right, maybe Chilton's just like, well, you know, that's Hannibal's doctor. Hannibal's allowed in here.
Mm-hmm. Or, so, you know, or, you know, yeah. Or there could
be... A friend of my friend is my friend.
Yeah, exactly.
A friend of my friend is my friend.
The friend of my enemy is my friend.
Well, I know, but, you know, by association, she's been vetted.
Okay, I can buy that. Yeah. But I think it's interesting.
Yeah.
Because he is a bad guy, right, according to the FBI.
Yeah, especially since almost everybody else has seen him
in
the weird, isolated cell. You know, that, you know, if you wanted to, you could go and put it in the ocean and, you know,
maybe,
go see sharks.
Maybe it's when guests come as a surprise, they see Will in his cell, when there's a scheduled visit. That could be.
Yeah, that makes a lot more sense. But I think it was also interesting that it was in the cell, especially when, Hannibal made the point of there's a line.
Right.
Because she does cross the line.
She does.
Yeah.
Quite
dramatically.
But before she does that, you're Hannibal Lecter's therapist. What's that like?
There's some great, and I thought it was interesting.
Will has gotten so snarky.
Yeah,
because
when she goes, it's like, I don't know you.
Yes, I don't know you.
I don't know you. which I loved that kind of, you know, and again, it's that, you know, he had done that in his backtracking. And when he was like, who are you? You know, and then to have, you know, her come in and kind of do the, you know, I don't know you.
Yeah.
You know, you could tell his brain is constantly putting pieces together, and he's had all these people that he knows
and now come in to see her,
and here's somebody new.
When I love their discussion about their sense of self, mm-hmm. and Will asks, isn't our sense of self created by our social ties? Mm-hmm. And Bedelia says, they certainly are in your case.
Yes.
So, that glorious moment where Bedelia crosses the line, mm-hmm. they lean in, it's got that almost erotic feel yeah. to it, and she whispers, I believe you. I should say that closer. I believe you. Lovely. Yes. And you almost see Will crumble. Mm-hmm. Because it's the first validation he's had.
Yeah.
You know, he's got his memories, the new ones that he's so excited about.
Right.
But this is the first external person who is on his side.
Yes.
And it's Hannibal Lecter's psychiatrist, mm-hmm. which means she might know something about that guy.
Right. Like, and again, and she does a lot of this interesting, like, another dance, mm-hmm. where she wants to tell people something. But she knows what not to tell them so that she doesn't incriminate herself or right. trigger them. You know, because she goes, you know, I am convinced that he has done what he has done because he honestly thinks, he's done what he has done because he honestly thinks it's good for you.
Right, yeah, defending Hannibal's actions.
Yeah.
Whether they're good or not.
Whether they're good
Hannibal
or not.
Hannibal had your best interests.
Right, and not to say that what he is doing is good.
Right.
But whatever twisted thing that is that he's doing, he honestly thinks.
And we talked about that in the first season, mm-hmm. how Hannibal was pushing Will to be better.
Mm-hmm.
What better meant for Hannibal Lecter is completely different than what better might mean for Will.
Exactly, exactly. I was desperately looking for my notes because I was like, I love when she goes, I wanted to meet you before I withdraw.
Before I withdraw, yeah. It's like Galadriel. I'm going to diminish and go into the West.
Exactly.
It's like, where are you going?
It's like, how many different ways can we say, I'm going to recuse myself?
It is a flamboyant show. It is delightfully flamboyant.
It is.
Okay, so Ophelia, you apparently disagree with me, and apparently us.
I don't know what
okay,
to feel.
Okay, well, let's talk about the final scene of the episode. Bedelia's house is dark
mm-hmm.
and theatrically abandoned.
Yes.
You know, with the sheets over
yes,
everything.
Yes, which I don't think anybody really does.
That's something you did in the 40s, right?
Exactly.
But honestly, yeah. It looks to me like she's skipped town.
Well, I think yeah. she has. But the So she put sheets over everything.
Right, yeah, okay.
Okay, so Hannibal is in his kill suit.
Mm-hmm.
And he walks in the door in his kill suit, which means he approached the house in his kill suit, which means he probably drove there in his kill suit. Let's just backtrack our way through the interesting, because we know he didn't just appear at the door
the
in the kill suit.
AC turned all the way on so in his car.
He walks in. Why else would he be there?
Or specifically in there in the kill suit?
Yeah.
Is it just you
have doubts?
I just have doubts if he wasn't just trying to scare her or
okay.
because of that whole you don't know what I'm capable of conversation.
Oh, yeah. He did say that was last season where he said, neither do you when it's the knowing what you're capable of.
You don't know
of.
What
yeah.
I'm capable
right.
of.
Right.
Yeah. Or they don't know what I'm capable of, neither do you.
Mm.
Whatever that exact line was. I guess he could have been going there to kill her, but having her have skipped town, just, I don't think he's going to pursue her or
no.
hunt her.
But. No. I just think he was ready to kill her.
Mm-hmm.
And he may be a little impressed that she got away.
Yeah. The speed. And
yeah.
Which would, and
I guess.
It was interesting. I guess they needed to sort of do
that. I mean, he's
that.
Not going to go sleep in her side of the bed. Try on some of her shirts. I mean, he's not mourning her vanishment like that.
I must touch everything.
He's wearing a kill suit, so he can't even roll around and get her scent. He's going to take off the plastic at some point.
Exactly.
I mean, I don't blame you, though, because there was a lot of discussion about this over on the This Is Our Design podcast, mm-hmm. where it was uncertain what he was doing there.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's not ambiguous. That's just my personal opinion, that he is there to kill her.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, I get the feeling that the kill suit is like his part of his weapon. If you see it, mm-hmm. you're dead.
Yeah.
You wouldn't see it. If you weren't going to die.
Because then what is he revealing? Consciously revealing.
He's revealing a very creepy side of himself.
Exactly. To someone who he is then not going to kill.
Yeah.
Is it going to be like, God, Bedelia, I dig you so much. I have to show you what I'm really like. this is the real me. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. It just seemed like that. It doesn't seem like Hannibal.
It's like the scene in Ed Wood where she goes in and he's there in Angora and the wig.
Mm-hmm.
So then Hannibal remembers.
Yes.
As he's smelling her perfume that she left for him.
Yes.
Which I thought was a really nice touch.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is Bedelia recognizing that part of Hannibal's routine was having her.
Mm-hmm.
And part of her was her scent and recognizing his involvement in that.
And also, if you've read the books and watched the movies, that's something that comes up.
Scent is very important.
It is the type of perfume.
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
That comes up a couple of times.
What does Clarisse wear? Rare de temps?
Yeah.
But not today.
But not today.
No, you use Evian skin cream. But not today.
But not today. Yeah. Near the end of Hannibal, she starts narrowing down where he is.
Oh, yeah.
Is because he knows through his scent what people wear. And,
right.
And if it's something like elaborate and expensive. And so that's one of the things she's actually looking for. The cars, the food, the perfume,
mm-hmm.
the cutlery, all of these. Because he will give them as gifts.
Right.
To people. So,
and he'll complain about Will Graham wearing something with a ship on the
bottle.
With
the ship on the bottle. And seeing that bottle there and having just read all that, because I finished Hannibal like a week ago, that I thought was a lovely thing plucked from Thomas Harris, and mm-hmm. that it was quite possibly a gift from him. That sitting in the room with her,
he
would smell what she wears.
And then
so he gave her
that perfume,
and her little, last wave goodbye is giving it back.
Wow,
And then he opens it and smells it and has that memory of her.
So we start season two off with a bang double feature here.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think? Season two living up to your exciting ideals of what it might be?
Yeah. I mean, like you said, it is, it's tighter. They have figured things out. I still get to have the delight of the craziest murders one can possibly think of.
They get better.
But it's nice that we're not trying to do it every week.
Right.
We're not trying to thoroughly dissect everything. Because I do like that they go back and forth. I like seeing a little bit of what's going on with the killer. And then we see what's going on with then we can see the lab, So it doesn't look all, it doesn't feel all procedural.
Right.
I really don't want it to be all
procedural.
And
they're recognizing mm-hmm. that the cornerstone of procedural is solving the crime.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't even, they finished the crime.
But
they didn't solve it because they have no idea.
Right.
And I think that was a refreshing thing.
I think it's also not necessarily that they let it go,
mm-hmm.
but that we don't need to see that they've continued an investigation beyond what we need to see.
Right.
We saw in this storyline, in this thing that's happening, this thing that's unfolding, we saw what we needed to see, which was Hannibal's interaction with the actual killer and that switching of places and him finishing. that is all that was necessary.
And Will saw what he needed to see.
Exactly. We don't need to know or watch the FBI continue to the conclusion.
Right.
Because it doesn't necessarily mean, because the episode is over, that everybody has packed up their toys and gone home.
There's still somebody looking for that guy. You know, they talked about, well, I hope he's seen a dentist.
Right.
Because they're going to check dental records. They're going to figure out who that guy is, maybe.
But that continuing story is not relevant to what we need to see.
Right.
So we can just go, oh, okay, they're going to go on and possibly find out, or it'll continue, or it'll be closed off as an unfinished case, or they'll figure out who it is. Mm-hmm. It's irrelevant. And it's nice that they don't feel like they have to waste our time with wrapping it up in a bow. We saw what we needed to see, and it's wonderfully open-ended. I think the last season, they kept trying to wrap everything up tight.
Yeah.
We're going to tell you every little
bit.
This
season is messy procedurally.
Yeah, it's tight. Fine.
It's tight story-wise.
Exactly. Script-wise. And that's the way it should be. That's definitely the way it should be. It's keeping me so much more enthralled. It's that whole thing of, I have, just like last season, there's no way you're getting a prediction from me. You can ask.
So I shouldn't say, you think Will's going to be behind bars.
If you want to ask, go ahead, if it makes you feel good.
I won't know, because, you know, I might ask you at the end of this season, because we don't know what's coming next season, except for Brian Spoilers Fuller just running around dropping every bit of information he possibly can. Exactly.
Pictures of locations.
I know the first three episode titles now.
Oh, wow.
I mean, it doesn't spoil anything, because the episode titles don't really mean anything to me.
No,
the
they don't mean anything to this.
There are three Italian courses.
Ah.
There's the antipasto, there's a primavera, and one other one. I don't remember.
Yeah, it's a meal in Italian.
It's an Italian meal.
Yeah.
And he revealed a place in Sicily that they're looking to do part of the shooting. So it's going to be lovely, is what it's going to be.
When I saw the photo online, it was exciting, because, like I said, I just finished Hannibal, and a good majority of it is in Italy. So I was wondering if the location is specifically chosen, because that is a...
Well, that I won't tell you, because that's spoilery. So I won't tell you that.
You won't tell me that.
So stop looking at photos online.
It comes up on my
whatever.
Do I have to unlike Brian Fuller?
You have to unlike Brian Fuller. Because seriously, he is going to spoil everything for you. All we need to do is make it another 11 weeks here. Okay. That's it. And we're through.
So then I can't put anything on Tumblr. Because
maybe you shouldn't touch Tumblr.
Okay.
Because it's all spoilers.
I was looking...
Everything I've put on Tumblr.
I followed Brian Fuller because you were like, oh, we have the Tumblr. You should put... I gave you the passwords. I was trying to be good and looking up stuff for Tumblr. And now you're telling me it's spoilers?
It's all spoilers. Everything is spoilers. Listeners, you should go onto our Tumblr. Miko can't, but you can. It's eattherudecast.tumblr.com. We're at eattherudecast on Twitter. Contact at eattherudecast.com via email. You can send Miko a message of support, miko@eattherudecast.com, and say it's going to be okay. Now, do not send her spoilers, or we will come at you hard.
You can send me something to put on the Tumblr that's not a spoiler. Apparently, I can't contribute to the spoiler, the Tumblr, because it's a spoiler.
You
Tumblr.
Can post things, you just can't look at them.
Oh, okay. That's good. So how do I find things?
Okay, I will let you do spoilers at your own clip. Because Netflix told us in research this last week that everybody loves spoilers.
Oh, so that's right.
If you want spoilers...
I don't want spoilers.
Okay, then you need to stop looking at Tumblr. If you don't want spoilers, you can't look at Tumblr.
Okay.
I'm not telling you you can't have spoilers. I'm just saying that both finales, season one and two, were so shocking because I had no idea what to expect.
Okay.
So, with that in mind, we're going to wrap it up for tonight. We will be back next week. We were sorry we missed last week, but we were all down sick.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't feel you wanted a podcast full of coughing.
Yeah.
Because there probably are podcasts full of coughing. And if you want that, you could probably subscribe to the coughing podcast.
Exactly.
The coughcast.
If that's your thing.
If that's
your thing.
If that's, if that's the way you you roll, right, you could subscribe to that. We should get that.
It probably gets reviewed on iTunes, too.
The best coughing podcast I've ever heard. Last week, they had a lozenge.
Right. Oh, my goodness.
Okay, so... thanks for joining us at the table. That's really, we already did the ending. We already did the wrap up. So it's just the end we need to get to. Thank you.